I'm telling you, we need a telestrator to break down just how impressive those plays were. And Wadaj was responsible for 50% of those plays. He is your 2024 Pittsburgh Regional Champion, was the NAIC champion the season prior, as well as winning Hartford. And then he was the NAIC senior champion back in 2022. Speaking of unique picks, Amanda, the Chestnut has really stood out. And that Shadow Alolan Sandslash has been so impressive when it's in the right position.
Yeah, we saw Elite Force to bring that Shadow Machamp against the team there, which did a lot of destruction, but Wadaj played so masterfully around it. A lot of really unique plays. His playstyle is something that we've been missing for the last season. It's a breath, a fresh air, but oh, yeah. Elam is a tried and true opponent that we've seen throughout the ages here. New Orleans top four, Charlotte Regionals top eight. Not only that, he was the regional finalist in Hartford and Baltimore in 2023.
Elam has been incredibly gritty. He definitely grins and bears it through the pain as he moves to the bracket, but he's got to be feeling good now because his Gastrodon Galarian Moltres core has taken him all the way to the Losers Finals in Baltimore, and he's been very, very impressive from start to finish.
Yeah, a lot of these trainers know each other. They know each other's playstyles. You can maybe can't see it in his face right now, but he is locked in, and he is ready to go there. It looks like both of these trainers are taking a moment to decide. It looks like they are actually locked in for battle pretty much at this point. It's going to be a decisive game, a best of five rather than a typical best of three, as we are in the Losers Finals, getting ready to hop into game number one.
Game number one is underway of your Losers Finals. Wadaj on the left, Elam on the right, Cresselia leading into Shadow for Alligator. We know that the Shadow Claws are going to deal some super effective damage, but the Grass Knot needs to be avoided by the Cresselia. Meanwhile, for Alligator can lance neutral Hydro Cannons, but it's got to respect these charge attacks from Cresselia.
Yeah, no reason to go for the Moonblast here. Grass Knot will be enough. Getting that first shield off of Elam here, but the Feraligator is just charging up a ton of energy already at basically 100%, throwing a Hydro Cannon, which will do a nice chunk of damage. He's really paying attention to how much energy is on the Cresselia. Wants to throw before another Grass Knot is going to be ready on that charge attack priority.
Wow, Wadaj is actually going to let the Shadow Feraligator go, excuse me, and he does have the Shadowlone Sandslash in the back, which is really interesting because when you give him switch advantage with that Pokemon on your team, you typically want to be very careful about it. But now he's got the Shadowlone Sandslash lined up against Elam's Cresselia.
Cresselia doesn't have the much of attack to go against the Shadowlone Sandslash. We do know that it is on Powder Snow, so the Shadow Claw damage is not going to be really effective there against the Cresselia because it's not even there. Wadaj getting a ton of energy before throwing here, basically at 100, going for the Drill Run, which is the heavier hitting attack. Cresselia has a lot of bolt to its name. Elam perfectly content to let this first one go.
Steel has been an incredibly awesome defensive typing, not only Pokemon Go, but all across all Pokemon properties. Actually protect shielding the Moonblast, Amanda. What's going on with this?
I think he just recognizes maybe his Alolan Sandslash has a lot of play, but he gets a debuff. You can tell he's not very happy about that. Moonblast doesn't have that high percent to do so, but it was able to. This Drill Run might not be able to knock out at this stage because of it, and the Powder Snows are not going to be able to either.
Wow, that's actually incredible. It allows Elam to get to the third Moonblast here against the Shadow Alolan Sandslash. Wadaj forced to let this one through. He cannot afford to give up his final protection at this juncture in the game.
Moonblast might not be very effective, but these Pokemon are so low at this point. An immediate clicking, you can see Wadaj is ready to swap right back into that Chestnut, now only to be met by that Clodsire. Those poison stings are starting to sting this grass and fighting type Pokemon. Meanwhile, just charging up to basically Frenzy Plant energy, going for that another charge attack priority.
Look at the charge attacks on Elam's Clodsire. This is Stone Edge and Earthquake. He does not have Sludge Bomb. The Chestnut is one of the hardest walls to Clodsire in all of Great League in this position. I think Wadaj is going to try to take that momentum here.
Yeah, we saw this before a lot of times with Azuma. He's still shielding it up. You can see he's not that happy about it. He wasn't expecting it maybe necessarily. Going up to 100 energy again, going for a Frenzy Plant at the same time. This Earthquake could be stored. Does Elam want to use this? A Frenzy Plant might knock out the Clodsire.
No, it doesn't. Absolutely not. Clodsire hangs on. That was easy. Here comes Elam with the Earthquake.
Speedy Sheep knowing how much his Clodsire can take from a Chestnut, because we've seen it so often. Very effective here. Coming back in for a switch.
Coming in with a Shadow for Alligator. I think hanging on through that Frenzy Plant might have been the most important play for Elam in this game number one. That Shadow Claw did go through. It switches out into the Shadow Alolan Sandslash. The big question, Amanda, is can this Sandslash get to a second charge attack?
It's one Powder Snow away, I believe, from another Drill Run, and it doesn't quite knock out, but he's at the Ice Punch when he doesn't throw. Shadow, both of them go down at this point. It's going to be neck and neck here. Chestnut able to take the win with Dodge taking game number one.
Absolutely incredible. Wadash comes out with the Chestnut there to Vine Whip down the Clawtire. Everything happened so fast, it was hard to keep track, but resisted or not, that Shadow Alolan Sandslash Powdered Snow was able to KO the Feraligatr at the same exact moment. If Feraligatr hangs on for just one more fast attack, it might have dealt a little bit of damage to the Chestnut and created a win condition for Elam, but Wadash executed it perfectly after coming back from a very tough position.
Yeah, as a reminder, turns are 0.5 seconds, and this game was so rapid paced near the end here, being able to farm down here. Look at barely any health, such quick decisions on both sides there. And as you can see, this drill run is not enough to knock out the Feraligatr. And though there is an Ice Punch stored, both of them go for a fast attack and get knocked out here.
It's so tough because if you're Elam, you see the Chestnut on the opposing side. It's such a unique core break Pokemon. And you look at your team and you think, well, I don't want it on Feraligatr, I don't want it on Gastrodon, I don't want it on Dunsparce, I don't want it on Clodsire. I mean, does that kind of force you to play Cresselia and Galarian Moltres?
Well, we'll have to see how Elam wants to adapt to this. He has been adapting all weekend, and he has been coming out ahead. As you can see, he is one of the three people finally left in this tournament. He's determined to make it to Baltimore Finals once again. Only has to get through Wadash to be able to get to that moment.
Exactly right, but that is a task for any trainer because Wadash is one of the best in the world. Again, this is the Losers Finals. It's a best of five. So we're gonna see these trainers play a maximum of five games. If Wadash wins the second one, he's not out of the woods yet.
I think a lot of times when it's a best of five, different strategies are employed. We'll have to see if this will be true because game number two is getting ready to start. You see Wadash smiling, giving a little bit of a nod because he recognizes that he's in a good position here with the Dunsparce against the Feraligatr. Feraligatr Shadow Claws not doing much and not even going for a Hydro Cannon right away, letting this first drill run go through.
You can see Elam's team composition is definitely correcting for the Chestnut threat. He not only has the Galarian Moltres in the back, but also the Cresselia, and I'm sure he is happy to lead the Shadow Feraligatr and not see that Chestnut on the other side. But only time is going to tell if Wadash can figure this out and find a way to beat Elam and his team composition.
Hydro Cannon coming through there, not before another drill run will go from Wadash's side, forcing that first Protect Shield from Elam, and he is at the energy. We'll have to see if Wadash wants to respond in kind or let that Dunsparce go down. Basically at two Hydro Cannons here, going a little bit over before throwing the first one, and Wadash comfortably saying, okay, Dunsparce, I guess you've done your job.
Look at the shield situation here. We've got a two shield advantage for Wadash as the Chestnut comes out, and now the Galarian Moltres comes out to play as well. We know that all these charge attacks are going to be heavily resisted by that flying typing on the Galarian Moltres, but still, Wadash wants to chip it down. He fires off the Frenzy Plant here.
Frenzy Plant will be able to connect, and it looks like it does a decent amount of damage. There's no Protect Shields remaining. Well, Elam has been playing this Moltres masterfully, however. Sometimes it goes for the Brave Bird, sometimes it's going for the Ancient Power. He's getting that shield regardless from Wadash's side, and a not very effective attack. But meanwhile, Wadash is continuing to farm away here, and with no Protect Shields left on Elam's side, this Moltres might be falling from the sky.
We thought that the Galarian Moltres would be the answer here, but it just got double Frenzy planted back into its Pokeball, and now the Chestnut has an energy advantage, it still has a Protect Shield advantage, and Elam does not really have a hard answer. This is looking actually really tough for him. He comes in with the Cresselia, gonna try to apply some Psycho Cut pressure.
Yet another one coming through here. Wadash just very calm and collected, letting Chestnut do Chestnut things, apparently. Frenzy Plant connecting. Cresselia is still in the green, but not by very much. Wadash has to flip into his own Cresselia, and Elam kind of shakes his head because this is a horrible position for him. Grassknot is loaded, Hydro Cannon is available, but will he be able to get the next one off before the Grassknot goes through?
Yeah, Elam probably hoping for a Clodsire or a Sandslash, gets the Cresselia, but this is massive as he's able to get off the second Hydro Cannon and maybe force away that Protect Shield. No, Wadash actually going to let it through.
I think Wadash is putting it all on Chestnut at this point. He did hit the Grassknot, so he knows he will be able to knock out the Feraligatr. It's going to be a Cresselia versus a Cresselia and a Chestnut in the back. Elam's going to have to do a lot of maneuvering around here. He's going to have a lot of precise counting. Once a throw before the Grassknot is loaded, that is wonderfully counted out by Elam here, letting this Cresselia go down. And now we have to see how much energy and health is Cresselia versus a shielded Chestnut.
Well, not only before the Grassnut was ready, but also before the switch timer. He wanted to make sure he could get the Cresselia before Widaj could catch. And look at Widaj. He's been so safe with his shielding as of late, and he decides to protect shield up the Grassnut, which is a huge, huge misplay because now he's got to fear the Moonblast. Meanwhile, that Frenzy Plant's almost ready. Here comes Cresselia with the Moonblast. It's going to come down to this, Amanda.
Will this Frenzy Plant knock out? We are all on bated breath to see if this will be enough. If it is not, it's going to set a charge attack priority time. Elam hits the Moonblast in time. This is enough to knock out the Chestnut with no Protect Shields remaining.
It looked really dire there for Elam in the middle part of the matchup. He had a 0-2 Protect Shield deficit. His Galarian Moltres got KO'd by Frenzy Plants of all things, and he still found a way to crawl back into this match with the Cresselia and take the win.
I just want to point out, we kind of mentioned it during the matchups as well, but both of these trainers are having such a wonderful eye on not only the switch timer, but they're managing to keep track of their opponent's energy throughout this entire thing. No matter how much dancing, how much switching around is going on, they're still just right on target, throwing right before attack is available or throwing when they know they will win that charge attack priority tie.
We saw Elam overcorrect a bit for that Chestnut threat, bringing both the Cresselia and the Galarian Moltres, the latter of which was very underwhelming as it wasn't even able to take a Protect Shield from Widaj. But at this point, Cresselia is flexing its muscles. We know that this Pokemon is very powerful. It's been strong for a very long time. I think that if there's one Pokemon that has to show up on Elam's team for Game 3, it's got to be Cresselia.
Cresselia has put in a lot of work. Widaj's Chestnut has also put in some work overall. I think if you're him, you want to make sure that you're keeping that Pokemon and keeping it protected. You saw how well it did against things that we thought it would even be hard countered by, such as that Galarian Moltres and the Cresselia. The Clodsire puts in a decent amount of work against it, but there is a lot of bulk on both of these teams. No fighting really type Pokemon except for that Chestnut, which threatens not only the Dunsparce, but also the Gastrodon with either one of its charge attacks.
No, I'm serious. Chestnut is a massive problem here. I'm very serious. This is my most serious.
This is his serious voice.
Chestnut is a massive issue for Elam. He can't let that Pokemon get an advantage. He has to contain it. That's like the most important thing for Elam in this series. Meanwhile, Widaj's primary goal has to be unleashing the Chestnut, clearing the barriers, and just letting it sweep through the back lines.
We are getting ready to jump into a game number 3. And we have a Feraligatr against Cresselia in the lead. I believe we had this in the previous game as well that went to Elam in the very last moments. It looks like both of them like to go a little bit above energy before throwing. Elam more than content to be able to shield up the first one and get a lot more damage from those Shadow Claws onto the Cresselia. Looks like it's going about the same as the last time, but I assume that they'll be playing things out differently very, very soon.
Elam gave up both of his Protect Shields in this matchup, like you called out, Amanda. I don't think he's going to do the same thing if I had to be a guessing man. I would say no. He's going to fire up the first Hydro Cannon. He's going to look for the second one almost immediately, I would presume, because he will win that charge attack priority tie. Actually, both trainers are switching, and this is perfect for Elam and really, really bad news for Widaj.
This is not a good point for Widaj to be in. Although he has up a shield there, the Frenzy Plants we have seen do a nice chunk of damage. That Moonblast will do so much more to a fighting type Pokemon. Elam going a little bit ahead on energy. He knows at this point. He knows from last game, Frenzy Plant's not going to be able to knock him out. Widaj has a decision to make. Does he want to use a shield here or not? He's going to let it go. Chestnut gets down super low, but not knocked out, and a Frenzy Plant will be at least a parting gift.
You can see Widaj is actually very happy about this. I'm sure I would be too, because the Chestnut hangs on, able to get the Frenzy Plant and almost knock out Cresselia, making it a prime farm target, but it also loaded the Moonblast, so it's going to be a threat to whatever Pokemon that Widaj sends in.
Widaj is sending in that Dunsparce, getting one rollout through before this Moonblast will hit. He does have his own Cresselia in the back in case he gets a debuff that he can clear later, but it looks like no debuff is there, but a Clodsire is coming in, one of the bulkiest Pokemon ready to absorb this Drill Run, even though this is a super effective. It's not going to be doing that much. Clodsire still will be in the green.
Absolutely will be. The Drill Run is super effective damage, but Clodsire is such a tank. The rollouts are barely doing any fast attack pressure at all. It's going to fire off a Earthquake. We see the first Protect Shield from Widaj in this game.
It's going to be Dunsparce against the World Base, but there's a little bit of health left on the Cresselia. I believe there is also some energy that we have to keep in mind. We definitely know that Elam hasn't forgotten about that. They're both of these trainers very locked in at this moment. Letting the second one go through. This Clodsire is getting low, but there is Shield parity and going for a combination play here. Wow. Did I say he didn't forget about the energy? He might have at this point, because now this Grass Knot will be able to connect, knocking out the Clodsire.
That's a heads-up switch, and he's able to get the KO. But now the Feraligatr comes out, and it's hungry. It's Shadow Claws down the Cresselia, and the switch and the catch. Elam breathes life into this game number three.
Wow, what an incredible catch by Elam there, getting his own Cresselia out as a sacrificial swap, but without much energy, two Hydro Cannons stored on this Feraligatr and shield parity. I think that this one might be going to the Feraligatr with that first Hydro Cannon coming through. Wadaj not even bothering to shield.
You can tell. I mean, Wadaj thought he did everything he could to put Elam away. He's like, man, I've thrown the kitchen sink across the table, and it's still not enough. As Elam takes a 2-1 lead over Wadaj in our losers finals.
Now, in a typical tournament setting here in Baltimore, this would be enough to secure Elam the deal, but this is a best of five matchup. All of the rest of the matches will be best of fives going forward for the rest of the day. So Wadaj still has a chance to tie it up and even win this series. These games have been so incredibly close. Let us know in the chat, who are you cheering for? Are you cheering for the person who ended up winning the first regional of last season, or our Baltimore finalist
from
2023.
Yeah, the big question is, can Elam reach that grand final stage again? And can Wadaj, fresh off of a long break from competitive Pokemon Go, can he come back just the way he used to be and topple Elam to punch his ticket to the grand finals?
Yeah, Wadaj is maybe like a bear that has been hibernating for the past season. He's only been getting stronger. He has all the nutrition and nourishment he needs to be able to be back at his final form. He's having a great showing of it so far. I think a lot of trainers have missed seeing his incredible plays, and it's wonderful to see him back on the stage.
As you move through a best of five series, the game plan can evolve and change over time. You have to remember not only what Pokemon on your team are strong against the opponent's overall team composition, but you have to take these mental notes of what they've been choosing to bring as well. Try to anticipate them the best you can. We've got some lock-ins on both sides. This is Wadaj versus Elam.
This could be a game-deciding matchup. If Elam manages to take this one, he will be into the grand finals, but he has to get through Wadaj, one of the toughest competitors in this Pokemon Go circuit. We have a Dunsparce versus Feraligatr Hydro Cannon coming through.
Hydro Cannon will deal severe neutral damage to the Dunsparce. Dunsparce can absorb one, but I don't think Wadaj is likely to take another one. Meanwhile, the Dunsparce has so much energy. Actually, the switch and the catch into Cresselia. Wadaj says, okay, I'll take this.
So it's not as horrible as you would think. It's not like it's going to be resisted damage or anything, and anything to chunk away at the health of this Cresselia is going to be needed. Wadaj more than content to stay in for a little bit longer, trying to get a catch of his own, but this is exactly where Wadaj wants the Cresselia. He wants to have the charge attacks that are not going to be doing much to the Alolan Sandslash. Just hoping he doesn't get those debuffs and he can really let this Alolan Sandslash go to work.
Yeah, definitely a very impressive awareness there by Elam. I think there was like a micro pause as well. He did not want to throw Grass Knot into a possible Alolan Sandslash switch in, and he does execute his plan perfectly. Second Moonblast coming through here. As we saw, judging by the first, this is not nearly enough to KO, but it does take Sandslash down into the red.
We throw in both Ice Punches, we throw in Drill Runs here. This is Shadow Damage, so doing 20% more than it would be from that Dunsparce in general as well. Going for a little bit more here, and maybe a miscount by Wadaj at this point, forcing him to shield this Grass Knot up because he was also at the attack. Maybe just wants to get a little bit more energy for whatever is coming in. But meanwhile, I have to keep attention to that switch timer because it is up, but Cresselia goes down.
And the whole reason here why Elam allowed Wadaj to farm down is because he didn't want to switch in the Feraligatr and be met by a potential Chestnut. So he does maintain his discipline, shields the Drill Run as well. But there's a second one to boot, and Elam is definitely losing ground here.
So, well, he's gaining ground. He's about to gain a Drill Run, in fact, into that Feraligatr, bringing it mighty low. But the Alolan Sandslash goes down. There's so much energy on this Feraligatr. We'll have to see how Wadaj wants to respond in kind. That Chestnut doesn't want to take an Ice Beam, and it's one away. Great prediction by Elam, going for the Hydro Cannon, getting a shield from the Dunsparce.
I think if you're Elam, you need to switch out immediately. The rollout might actually be enough to KO. No, excuse me, Feraligatr hangs on, so there's always that potential for a sacrificial swap later on in the battle. But for now, Dunsparce fires off the Drill Run, and Wadaj has not even shown his Chestnut yet.
It's all about what could potentially be in the back, right? If you're Elam, you're probably thinking it's going to be that Chestnut. What is going to do more damage? A Frenzy Plant or a drill run, and he correctly shielded up that first drill run, but as you can see, the super effective damage is going to continue to whittle away here at Pokemon. He's got another drill run loaded. Elam has to throw an attack to get this Dunsparce out. He's not going to be able to poison Sting down.
I'm telling you, Amanda, this is not just a rollout. This is like an avalanche of charge attacks coming from that Dunsparce, and now the Clodsire is going to be forced to throw the Earthquake into the Chestnut. It's same type attack bonus. Both attacks are resisted by the Chestnut's typing, but that Earthquake is just a little bit more potent. Meanwhile, Elam does have the opportunity to catch. He switches in the Feraligatr, but it fizzles out as soon as it hits the field, and Wadage is going to tie up this series.
Wadage taking this game with a Frenzy Plant to the Clodsire. That's definitely enough to knock out a Pokemon in this low range. Tying this up, we're going to a decisive game number 5 in the Losers Finals here in Baltimore.
I wouldn't want it any other way, Amanda. This has been a thrill to watch, and as much as these competitors want to succeed, it's so much fun, and it benefits everyone watching when they battle more. We want to see more games because these trainers are just on a new level that we have not seen yet in this tournament.
So this is where the pressure is definitely on, right? I mean, this is the point where it is the go big or go home moment for both of these trainers. Both of them obviously want to be able to take that title, with Dodge saying earlier on in the day, I would love to keep winning. He is on the loser side of the bracket, but it was his first loss fresh off of it against Elite right before this point. He still has a lot of momentum behind him.
No, he absolutely does, and I think he's showing his grit and determination as well. Both of these trainers have had to fight their way through the loser's bracket in previous regional championship competitions, and a lot of the time you kind of wonder, is their mental going to waver? Are they going to not be as confident in themselves? But I think that Elam looks great. He's in great shape. He lost that game number 4, but he still seems to have enough fight to try to muster a solid attempt at game 5, and Wadage, in the meantime, I mean, he looks solid. I think Wadage's mental state is in great shape.
Yeah, he was saying earlier, he's had some time to play the game. He's really liking this new meta. It seems fresh. One thing I want to point out about Elam as well is, though he has not had a championship title to his name, so many trainers that have played against him mention him as one of the opponents that they fear the most. S. James P, that when he played against him in Indianapolis, said, "This is the trainer that I was like worried about. If anyone would take a game from me, it's gonna be Elam." We'll have to see if he can take game number 3 as we see that Galarian Moltres up against the Chestnut. We'll see how Wadage wants to respond.
This is a complete change in strategy for Elam. He leads to Galarian Moltres with his Gastrodon in the back with his Cresselia. Meanwhile, that Shadow Ball and Sandslash is there. If Elam can maintain control switch advantage, I think he's got a fighting chance. Wadage needs to prevent that from happening.
This Frenzy Plant we saw earlier on when there were no protection shields used, it actually does quite a bit to this Dark and Flying type Pokemon. Meanwhile, just gaining up a ton of energy, and Wadage correctly shielding up the Brave Bird. This is huge for Wadage.
Yeah, he says, "You're not going to bamboozle me, right? I'm going to go ahead and use a protect shield." It's going to fire the Frenzy Plant. Elam might be inclined to shield as well. If he wants to go to a shield down situation, he needs to do so in order to fire off the second Brave Bird. That's what we get.
And he's going to go ahead and do exactly that, going for yet another Brave Bird here. Does Wadage want to go 2 shields down? It looks like he is. He's very thinking that the Chestnut is going to be the Pokemon that is going to bring him victory. Because this is double debuff now, might be able to completely Vine Whip down. Not often you see that to a Flying-type Pokemon.
Elam brings in the Cresselia into the Chestnut. We see the instant pivot out into the mirror. Cresselia, this is actually huge because Wadage went into the mirror match instead of his Sandslash.
This is big. I think he recognizes how much play that Chestnut still has in the back. This Moonblast will be able to go through. It connects with the Cresselia. You don't see a defense drop on either side at this moment. Wadage is gaining a ton of energy on his own Cresselia before deploying that Moonblast of his own.
Yeah, I think he's going to bank up some extra energy just in case Elam reaches for the swap. Moonblast comes through. It does have a chance to debuff the attack of the opponent, and it does not trigger here in the Cresselia mirror match. Meanwhile, Elam fires off the Moonblast in kind.
This is going to be a long matchup if both trainers choose to stay in it, because Cresselia has a lot of bulk, and neither one of these attacks are going to be doing that much. As you can see, both of them going for the Moonblast because it is going to be slightly or heavy-hitting, and like we mentioned, it does have a chance to debuff your opponent's attack. Once again, going for the Moonblast on Wadage's side, and Elam now down to the yellow on his own. Elam is up 1 shield. Wadage has no shields left, but he does have a ton of energy on his Chestnut in the back.
Elam actually deciding to go for the Grass Knot. I mean, I think you need two charge attacks either way, so the double Grass Knots probably makes more sense in terms of energy efficiency. He lands the first one there. We see the charge attack party tie, and this time with Dodge wins it. Elam lets it go. He's putting it all on the Gastrodon.
Looks like the Moonblast will connect, but it's not enough to take it out. He did already attack, but look at this. The attack falls at this low range. Will the Grass Knot be enough? Because it's not that heavy hitting, even undercharging by Elam a little bit. Looks like it's not quite enough to knock out, and in comes the Chestnut here, completely Vine Whip down, even with one shield remaining. There's so much energy on this Chestnut.
We see two Frenzy Plants loaded. Elam gets the Mud Slap through, but he knows that's his last Mud Slap of the tournament. With Dodge, is going to win the Losers Final. 3-2 in a decisive game number 5.
We saw the Gastrodon and then we missed the Gastrodon as it was one hit KO'd by that Frenzy Plant.